Hachette Audio presents Save Yourself. Written and read by me, Cameron Esposito. Dedication. To every queer kid, be little and bitty or all grown up. Introduction. Growing up in the 1980s and 90s in suburban Chicago, I didn't know gay people were real. I thought gay people and leprechauns were mythical creatures for parades, with hats and buckles, and some of that's true. I do own several buckles. Before the L word was pitched, when Lena Waithe and Kate McKinnon were kids, lesbians existed, but I couldn't see them, or hear them, or look them up because there was no internet. Ellen had a scripted show on the air, and I wasn't allowed to watch it. Mix DeGeneres hadn't yet voiced a fish, created a talk show suitable for any doctor's office, or even publicly come out, but my very Catholic parents sensed the cut of her Birkenstock, and your Grandpa Cameron wasn't allowed to watch her show. At 20, when I realized I was gay, I imagined I'd spend my adulthood alone, a friendless lesbian match girl at society's window, pleading to be let in, and my eternity in hell, barbecuing alongside monsters who killed people, or ate people, or ate people they killed. Then I fell in love, found comedy, and met some people who weren't Catholic or weren't as Catholic as me. Slowly, over years, I worked to accept myself as perfectly fucking normal and okay. Now, because of my job, I often present only that part of me to the world. But there are other parts. There's this scene in the 1972 film version of Cabaret where Liza Minnelli's character, Sally Bowles, is backstage about to walk out and perform at the Kit Kat Club. It's 1931. It's Berlin. And things are about to be awful. Also, Sally has just had an abortion, which is kind of messing with her bod, and she's emotionally raw because she's kind of going through two breakups at once, and then there's the fucking Nazis to think about. Anyway, Cabaret is a very good movie. The scene I'm talking about is maybe 2 seconds long. I first watched it with my big deal ex, you know, the one who is my first real adult, I'm in my mid-20s partner, who I thought I'd maybe marry even though same-sex marriage was then illegal. My big deal ex was a modern dancer, obviously, like my older sister, and showed me Cabaret because the dang movie is directed by Bob Fosse, and when you spend a lot of time around dancers, you learn that apparently it is possible to tuck your tailbone, and that I should, in fact, tuck my tailbone, and you also learn about Fosse, and Tharp, and Ailey, and Baryshnikov, before Carrie Bradshaw. Here's the scene. It starts out dark, the curtains are closed, Sally is alone, head down, looking nowhere at nothing, and it's just her vulnerable, real, suffering self. Then the curtains open, light floods over her, and in the time it takes her to raise her head, her face, her whole being is transformed. With a wide red grin and confident shoulders, she walks out on stage. And when she does, she stops time. She owns herself and you've agreed to be owned, and you're happy about it. And that's what it feels like every time I do stand-up. Each time I step on stage, I leave my small, worried self behind and become a version of me that is power and projection. On stage, I'm your daddy. Backstage, I'm upset and critical. So maybe your father? Here's just one example. It's September 3rd, 2013. I'm performing on The Late Late Show with Craig Ferguson. It's my first time on network television. The curtain opens and I walk out on stage and honestly, crush, Sally style. Craig and Jay Leno, the other guest that night, interrupt my set and call me over to the couch, the biggest compliment a stand-up comic can get. And I sit between them, my feet not touching the ground, even though I'm sitting in a fairly low chair because I'm the size of a Tamagotchi. My then partner is in the green room, watching the taping beside the show's producers, and the room erupts with cheers when I'm invited to the couch. My parents watch the broadcast, and I give them a shout-out. It's 1 year to the day since I moved to Los Angeles, and my hope is that this TV appearance will put them at ease, that they'll scream, "She made it!" at one another before collapsing into each other's arms, exhausted. Because there was a long time when they and I thought I wouldn't make it, not as a comic, but as a human, as a queer, gay, lesbian human being, which I am. People frequently come up to me after shows and tell me I'm the first out gay person they've met. This still happens. Today, the day you are listening to this happened. I'm sure of it. Some are straight and I've changed their minds about queer folks. Some are queer folks raised with a few more queer characters on TV but still isolated in the real world who see in me an example of a possible future they might have, with a career and an extensive collection of button-downs. I'm proud of that, but it feels a little like only watching that one scene in Cabaret, and I'd like to tell you the whole fucking queer as hell story. This is a book about the small, worried guy left backstage. It isn't a sidebar to a straight person's rebirth. I don't give a makeover or plan a wedding or get a couple back together. It's not a tragedy. I don't die at the end of this book having finally decided to kiss the girl. It's honest and bumpy and scared and sexy and real. It's the dyke's tale my younger self needed to read, and I hope you enjoy it. Cammie's note. It would seem that as this book publishes, I will have an even bigger deal X. It's an excruciatingly painful loss, and I chose not to write about it in this book, except here where I'll say, God damn it! Chapter 1, Little Gay Kid. Today I am a big gay adult, but I got my start as a little gay kid, LGK. In between, I was several other things, including a preteen battling her body, the proudly abstinent girlfriend of the captain of the football team, and an actual Republican. So it was a bit of a winding path from little gay kid to big gay adult. I grew up the tough, square-jawed middle sister in a fiercely Italian, very Catholic family. My hometown is an idyllic suburb 15 miles west of Chicago called Western Springs, and can best be described as quaint. It's like the village in Hot Fuzz, but no one's gone missing and instead all 13,000 inhabitants are happy and fulfilled. Across from our George Carlin-less Shining Time station, there's a fruit store called, wait for it, Fruit Store. The two-block strip of downtown holds a butcher, a baker, and several places wherein candlesticks can be purchased, though not from their original maker. The baker makes legendary smiley face cookies frosted with either pink or yellow buttercream. Even the cookies are happy. We also had a literal milkman, a good 40 years after the rest of the country decided to suck it up and go to the store to get their own damn milk. Not us. We lived blissfully behind the times in a land where front yards were large, divorce rates were low, nearly everyone was white, and all those white people went to church on Sunday. And goddamn if it wasn't friendly there. We knew our neighbor's neighbor's dogs' names. Every June, we'd put costumes on those dogs and on ourselves and march in the annual pet parade held one town over. There was AYSO soccer in the summer, king-size candy bar trick-or-treating in the fall, caroling in the winter, and rollerblading in the spring. Now, when I say I was raised very Catholic, I mean I attended Catholic school, said rosaries during my free time, and eventually became an altar server. A sort of priest's assistant and rather new role in the church for gals because in Catholicism, women are for listening. I had this tiny plastic bottle marked holy water that contained, you guessed it, holy water, which is water a priest has been nearby and said some words over, and I used it to bless myself before falling asleep under this huge poster of a pretty scared-looking polar bear wandering through the snow that I had framed because myself, a scared white animal, wandering through a white world. It just felt so me. My family prayed before dinner and had filet of fish on Fridays during Lent. My parents both grew up in the kind of Italian Catholic families that made their own wine in the basement and their own sausage in the kitchen. They attended Catholic grade school and Catholic high school and met at a Catholic college. When it came time to raise their own family, they started us early with all Catholicism, all the time. My mom and I said Hail Marys together as she braided my hair. My dad, a lawyer, often stopped at a chapel downtown to pray before going to court, which would be unfair to opposing counsel if prayer affected legal outcomes. My sister Allison and I played church-inspired games. One favorite was Mass, in which we'd line up our stuffed animals, or our grandparents, whichever was around, for a quick sermon about Muppet babies. My sister and I took turns priesting, and my Nana took the Eucharist with a solemn body of Christ and an amen. If those years of at-home games of Mass taught me anything, it would be to recommend thinly sliced bananas or better cheddars as a great stand-in for Eucharist. And if you use bananas, may I recommend leaving them out for a bit after slicing to allow the fruit to brown up a bit and more naturally match the skin tone of real Jesus, who, I was shocked to learn in college, was Middle Eastern and so probably looked Middle Eastern. Another beloved game was Birth of Christ. Allison was Mary and I was Joseph, naturally. And she would deliver a Cabbage Patch Kids doll into a brown piece of Tupperware with a yellow pom-pom inside. The hay was essential to make the manger feel true to life.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.